Yeah, we on Boss Talk 101. Yeah, we gon' talk, we gon' have fun. We be on fire, we be lit. It's a unique hustle.
Check it. This evening, cause it's your boy ECO, and I'm here with the lovely, amazing official Miss Jamaica. What's going on?
Nothing, you know my dad walk on.
Man, you know what? God is good, man. You know, I done stumbled up on the gym, man. You know, this guy right here, man, he really don't need no introduction, man. When it come down to the culture, he one of those guys, man. You know, one of the pillars of our community that you have to look up to, man. Family is what I think about when I look over at it, man. Mr. Bill Haney is in the building, man. What's going on?
Hey, man. Thank you, the Box Talking. Thank you guys for having me. It's only right that you're in Las Vegas, and I come down and kick some real boss talk with you. Real, you know what I mean? Officials.
Man.
You know what I mean?
Man, listen, man. Hey, man, I ain't gonna lie to you, man. I was excited when, shout out to Black Man, Fight Fan, man. On another level, man. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
And CC, man, you know.
Absolutely. Shout out to the King and the Queen, Black and CC, both doing their thing. CC is doing amazing. She's hit the space, and she's running. You know what I mean? So I'm a big fan of what she's doing. I'm a big fan of what they're doing. And, I'm thankful to them for, the introduction. So thank you.
I'm going to pass it off to the queen, man. She always start me off. That's how we get them every time. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, but before we get them, y'all don't forget to like and subscribe, share our content on all social media platforms, Facebook, TikTok, YouTube. I mean, everywhere. Snapchat, too, if you need it. But guess what? The most important part you need to do is Patreon. That's where you're going to find our full-length interviews after a while. It won't be on YouTube anymore. It'll be only on Patreon for a small membership fee. Okay? Thank you in advance.
Man.
Well, everything that you said, just go. Everybody go on TikTok. I'm on TikTok. Bill Haney, no. And that's something that my daughter, shout out to my beautiful young queen, Arabella. She's 8 years old, and she's introduced. Yeah, she's introduced the TikTok and the whole YouTube and streaming.
8 years old, and she's doing all that.
Yeah, she's doing all that.
Wow.
And I'm totally behind her and supportive of her like I am with all my kids. I'm happy to say that I represent an organization called Parent to Partner.
Oh.
And we help the parents find the tools needed to transition to a partnership with the children.
With the children, because there's always that gap where why the time is not being spent, because they don't understand what their kids are doing, or they're doing, you know, because kids are always just on their phones.
Yes.
And then most of the time they don't want to show us what they're doing anyway. We just have to be nosy to see what it is and ask the right questions. That's one thing I learned about being a parent is you can ask questions, but are you asking the right question to get the answer you really need?
Absolutely. And are you prepared for the answer?
Exactly.
And, you know, so many times that we're captivated by whether it be the stars in the sky or whether it be the stars on television, YouTube, et cetera, I found a way to look for the stars in my children.
Mm.
And, you know, I believe that God has given everyone something, and it's just about supporting what they're passionate about.
That's true.
My son that everyone is more familiar with, the undisputed champion of the world, we started out with the negative. He was in the principal's office. He was being suspended. He was being described as everything but
a trouble kid.
Yeah. He had all those things that I didn't want to accept. I didn't want to accept that my kid was those things that he was being described. And after the last time of being in the principal's office, I decided to take him to the boxing gym. I said, you know, if you know how to fight and you're not scared to fight, let's go to the gym.
How long did it take you to get to that point? Because how long, you know, was he given trouble and trouble and trouble before you decided to do that, take that step?
Oh, yeah. You know, it was a...
Was it years?
Yeah, it was. He was about eight years old. Yeah, when I took him to
when
the
you
gym.
Took
so,
him?
You know, and people always like ask, when you say fighting a kid, well, if they're in the back room, you know, you don't want your kid to be the one in there that's doing the crying when we go in there as parents, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But also, we don't want them to be a troublemaker.
The bully at the same
bully.
Time.
So it's,
right.
it's a fine line. And growing up in East Oakland, you want to teach your kid, boy, I don't want you to be in there crying, and don't be coming and telling me you better hit the boy back or something like that. So when we moved to Las Vegas, we weren't in an environment that he should have been so conscientious of being hit. And when the kids would talk, what we call talking crazy, and he said to me in front of the principals, I said, what's going on? He said he was about to hit me. I said, no, you knew you wasn't supposed to say that. Wrong with you. I told you that at the house, if they hit you, somebody about to hit you. Don't say it in front of the principal. Right. It's all right, you know what? I said, well, as soon as we got in the car, and he was just looking out the window, I said, you think you tough, so I'm going to take you to a gym and see, can you fight? He looked back and he said, okay.
He ready.
And then looked back out the window, I said, I can't wait to find somebody to tear his tail up. But then I go to the boxing gym, and ironically, we put him in there and, you know, to teach him a lesson. And, you know.
And he loved it.
And, well, not that he just loved it. He was talented in it. You know what I mean? He sparred a kid on the first day. And, you know, he was impressive.
You were shocked out of your mind.
I was shocked. The trainer that was there, he said, your kid is a natural. And remember, I'm hearing all these other descriptions of him, but never that he's a natural, he's talented or anything. But when we went to the boxing gym, he was like, man, your kids are natural. Wow. All the other people, kids. And
that was looking, a blessing.
Right? And so our whole testimony and our story is like, so we kept going and going and going. When I found it, I said, how many other parents have kids that have these descriptions and they're, you know, that they end up in juvenile hall or they end up in the streets or whatever, right? So we never would do a deal with anyone because I think it would misrepresent what a father and a son could actually
do together.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So we just kept using the momentum and using the energy that we're doing it for the people. And one day it's going to be a father and son come right behind us.
Right.
And they're not going to have to work as hard.
Exactly.
You know? Because it's not easy.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. No,
it's not easy to get out and trailblaze and pioneer something that's not there. So for us, Devin at 23 years old, he's the undisputed champion of the world. And we're doing some things that another big guy in this town hasn't did yet. You know what I mean? So we're happy. We're in a good place. But I'm very supportive of trying to find the passion and my kids, whether they're being a comedian, right? Because, you know, with the YouTube thing and whether they're into fashion, blogging, right? I feel like that I'm a parent that's a little bit more open to a non-traditional income or a non-traditional career than what my parents.
Exactly. You know, parents back in the day was like, what you doing? Go get a real job.
Yeah. And I don't want to lose the relationship or lose the ability to help support my kids and they have something passionate that they're talented.
Man. But I want to go into, because we usually start like back into history first before we jump all into that.
Okay.
But because when you say that he was given trouble, what was the cause of given trouble? Because, you know, were you and your his mom together growing up?
No. We had separated. I'm from Oakland. She's from San Francisco. I always wanted.
How old was he when you separated?
Probably like around. Maybe 1 week or 2 weeks old.
Okay. So, okay.
You said it was gonna be boss talk.
It's real. Like,
So, and that's what it was. But previous to that, with my older son, I went to the penitentiary. I went to the federal penitentiary. I went there for 60 months.
For 60 months.
Yeah, I went for 60 months and. When I got out of that, just having my son have to see me in the penitentiary,
man,
and my
it's
father,
and
it was just gut wrenching. So to get out and then to meet his mom, and then to find out that she was pregnant and stuff like that, I knew that I had to get on my grind and get out of the streets. You know what I mean? So we weren't, you know, I care about her and everything. You know, to this day, you know, for giving me my son, but we're at different points at each other's lives.
Right.
You know what I mean? I just came home from prison. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So I'm still a little wild.
No.
What I mean? And she's a little bit, a lot more conservative. Mm-hmm. So it didn't last, but
how old was you when you went to?
When I went? So I went when I was 22 years old, 21, 22.
Yeah.
Right? And it was funny because, you know, what everybody is saying that, oh, you know, I got all these false safes, like I'm not gonna go to jail because I got somebody that's gonna go for me.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I had a homeboy, you know, he's still my friend to this day, right? And I told him, I said, you know what? I thought I missed the plane and my flight because I was messing with this girl or whatever, just, you know, being young. And I said, you know, I'm gonna go ahead and get on the flight with you. But nigga, if something happened, nigga, you know what you gotta do. You know, that's your job. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Right? And lo and behold, we're young, stupid, thinking that they, you know, don't know about conspiracy and all that stuff. You know what I'm saying? So they linked us both together, right? And when they charge us and all the shit, right? we in the back and go to court. We doing shit, and we've been talking, and I said, well, man, when are you gonna tell the people so they can cut me loose and I can go home? You know what I'm saying? Because why do two people need to go for the shit, right?
That's right.
So he said, man, all right, man. You know what I'm saying? And all right, so I said, all right, cool. I said, he is going to go and go let the people know I'm going to get out and I'm going to take care of him and life going to be it. Forever after, right?
That's how
I'm letting all these young people know it's not going to go like that.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, you dick the motherfucker. He's saying he's going to take it, but he's not going to take it.
No.
Right? So the homie, he get up in court and he sit there and he looking, judge talking. I'm looking over at him. I said, when you going to do it? He just stood up right in the middle of the shit and he said, let this nigga go. I done did it. The judge said, one more outburst out of you and you're going to be held in contempt.
He didn't know.
He might have knew, but he didn't know. We around the same age, and that's what I'm telling people. Listen, I'm going to tell you, because we was out of town. I ended up going to trial still, but what I know now is the homie didn't want to be there by himself.
Yeah.
He wanted, you know what I mean? It's hard to get in trouble and then say, okay, I'm a man up. I'm about to go do this. Mm-hmm. You go on home.
By myself.
What I'm saying? It's easy to say, and that's why I let all the people know. That's why I don't do nothing now.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And I knew once I caught my break, and I'm not saying to everybody, you know what I mean, stop doing what you're doing. But if you didn't caught a break, man, you better get out of there, man. Mm-hmm.
You better
leave that thing alone.
No, that's
you
real.
Know what I'm saying?
That's real.
You see what I'm saying? So I ended up, so people know what happened with the story. I ended up going to trial because I didn't really believe I did shit. My man ended up pleading guilty. You know what I'm saying? We ended up going back in the bullpen and stayed together until they separated us. We fought side by side. That's but right. I knew then that,
you know what I mean?
He wanted me to do that bit. He wanted me to do that bit with him. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? He wanted me to stay there with him and be side by side friends, cook soups together and do all the shit.
How long did you stay in there?
I did 60 months. Years, 60 months.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
60 months, man. You know. I always ask this because I have a lot of people that come on and been locked up. Like, what was the defining moment for you in when you were incarcerated?
My son coming up there, you know?
That's real.
And my dad
coming
up there. That was just, you know, to have a responsibility because all of the cars, all of the jewelry, everything that I hustled for, it was a made-up responsibility.
Mm.
The only responsibility that God gave me was the one that he gave me that was my kids.
That's real.
Mm-hmm. That's just the one responsibility that I got. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. That I chose went with his mama for us to lay down. It was a chance that we would make this happen.
Mm-hmm. Oh, for sure.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
And I did it, and I felt like I let him down.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I felt like I misprioritized what it was because at that age, like with my daughter, and I tell people, I'm like, at 8 years old, she don't need no more money. She need her dad.
That's real.
But at that age, did you know God?
Man, not like I do now. You know what I mean?
There's a difference.
No, not at all.
Because when you have somebody to answer to like that, you have another way of thinking compared to when you're young. You're just thinking about just moving, doing right at that moment in time. You're not thinking about anybody else or anything else.
Yeah, no, I didn't. Thinking back on it, I think that might have been what was necessarily missing
right.
in my life at that point in time. Thinking back, as you mm-hmm. said, it's one thing that I didn't have. I had everything else, but I didn't have a strong faith or a belief mm-hmm. in God at all.
You know, I'm going to go back a little farther. You from East Oakland,
mm-hmm.
and you one of them guys that you was dealing with music and all kind of stuff from what right. I'm hearing.
Right.
So you wasn't just no regular, you know, and the people I talked to be legit about a few days back, you know, when I was saying, man, I'm gonna be in Cali. I was just trying to figure out who gonna be where, you know. He said, man, I'm in Oakland. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
Like, I need to go up there. I really, really want to go up there and do some interviews, right?
Right.
But I just got to figure out when we gonna do it. We got so many people that's telling me we won't come here in Miami or whatever. But anyway, Oakland is something different because it wasn't about gangs and stuff up there. It's more about pimping and players. And we had what a couple of them from up there that was real live pimps.
What you mean? But see what happens in Oakland is an independent man, a thinker, right? It's just no gang banging because we're so of the mindset that whatever street you from,
yeah,
that's the street you from. Ain't no help. You got to ride for the street. You got to ride for your neighborhood. You got to ride for that street. Ain't no what we call turf hopping.
Yeah.
You hopping around from set to set. You know what I'm saying? My particular neighborhood been up and down like a roller coaster until I got on.
Okay, okay.
Now we up.
Hey, that's all.
You know what I'm saying? But we're up to the point that I'm the first guy that where I could be strong and I could press my neighborhood, I could press my city. I wanted to be the first nigga to walk away on top. I drove up out of there in the brand new Bentley GT, you know, the Rolls, all the shit. You know what I'm saying? That goes along with in the game. But for me, it meant being an example of walking away on top.
This whole
not coming out of jail, not having a problem with somebody. There's not no nigga that goes on the internet and say he got a problem with me for about nothing.
Nothing.
So before I ever came on the camera to talk to anyone about anything, I had to straighten out my business and make sure that, you know what I mean, I'm really coming correct. And I don't know a bunch of guys that say that they started from a $20 rock.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it was important. I don't know too many guys that said respectfully, no thank you, Mr. Carter, Jay-Z.
Yeah.
Respectfully, but no thank you, Mr. Mayweather.
Respectfully,
but no thank you to, you know, 50.
That's all.
Birdman or you know what I mean? With my son. But what I'm saying is that I say it out of respect that even with Jay, is that you've paved the way for Devin and me to do what we do. Too short, out the trunk. You've paved the way for us to have, you know, to understand what sweat equity meant, right? So we was putting money in the bank when we were just putting sweat. You know what I mean? We didn't have the investment capital, but we was constantly in the gym. We was constantly working on our brand on a digital perspective. When YouTubing was just kind of starting,
yeah,
right? And you know what I mean? We would go down to Mexico, film it, then upload it to YouTube. Well, when I went back to talk to the executives in television, they're saying that a YouTube presence doesn't mean anything.
Wow.
A digital presence doesn't mean anything. It's all about getting on television, on linear television.
Right. Yeah.
You know
yeah.
what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Well, now everybody got a phone in their hand and it's in flip. So I don't know what the new analytics on it is. Is it more houses or digital or more houses or linear? But I know that, you know, we doing great in this
Man.
Space. You know what I mean?
Yes, sir. I when I think about, like I said, you guys definitely, to me, the father and son, that's always a great dynamic for me, no matter how you look at it. Because it's hard to, man, I just always feel like it's hard to mess with a guy when he got his dad in his corner. You know what I mean? Like, this is real solid, man. Especially a brother that been through what you done been through. I don't play with that. I know already. I know where you've been. You had time to think. Well, a lot of people don't have time to think, Bill. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And that time to think, it gives you a little leeway because it pushes you further ahead for me. I mean, I think you could see things coming from, you know, in slow motion a lot
right.
of time because you had time to think about all the different situations that come your way when you've been through situations, right?
Right, absolutely.
And so
I keep wanting to go back over here. I hear your music background is heavy. You know what I'm saying? People tell me wait a minute, from Ice Cube and was it Yo-Yo? I done heard all kind of stuff about you, Bill.
Yo-Yo.
So you going to have to give me these stories, man. You know what I'm saying?
It wasn't the King Cube. It was the Queen Yo-Yo that I had a long relationship
with.
And you know, but that was a relationship and it wasn't business. And it was one of the best things that had happened to me at that particular time in my life, you know, coming from Oakland and knowing Short and
correct
and knowing 40 and knowing all of them, right?
MC Hammer,
all of them,
you know everybody,
all of them. And the thing that I always say is it was good that my son believed in me the way that he did,
okay,
you know, blindly, you know what I mean,
correct,
for us to, you know. And I couldn't be having a better time in my life. You know what I mean?
I get it.
I wouldn't have wanted it to happen in my 20s.
Now. I agree 100%, man.
You know?
I definitely, I'm just proud to be sitting here with you. Somebody sent me something about Bernard Hopkins the other day. It was something he said, man, I guess you just had something to wear. You spoke on Bernard Hopkins. What was that about?
Well, I was just speaking on Bernard, speaking on the young guys of today. And it's easy to say what the young guys aren't doing in comparison to the OGs. But, you know, I remember, right? I remember not having the cell phones.
Yeah.
Right? I remember not having all those things, right? I remember going out the house and you had to go straight. You had maybe 10 cent for to use the telephone, 10, 50 cent or whatever, to make a call, but you were to go straight there and you were to come straight back. They weren't all the distractions now. You know
correct,
what I mean?
Correct.
So with the kids now, like, you don't know if they're going to make it over there. Did they post something? Did somebody head them off? You know what I mean? So at the same time, like, with the distractions that they have now and those that are still focused, let's give them their props.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
As young, and especially the ones that with Bernard Hopkins saying that, listen, any of those guys, any of you guys that's not in jail, not selling dope, not robbing, bipping, you know what I'm saying, doing all the stuff, credit card scamming.
Yeah.
I kind of hold them in a different light because I come from that.
Correct.
So I know we really got respect for the real ones that stay on course. You know what I mean? If you don't have no respect, then you ain't been in the streets.
Yeah.
If you think that this shit is fly and this shit is a place to be, then I don't know.
Yeah, no, I agree.
I don't know. I might need to talk to you because I don't, all the guys that I hang out with and the nights that we spent, we always said, or when we was in jail, we said, man, we can't wait to get out of this shit.
That's what I keep hearing. I keep hearing that a lot of street cats can't wait to get out when all these rappers rapping like they're in the streets or want to be in the streets. It don't make no sense. And they have every opportunity to be out of the street and stay out of the street.
No, absolutely. And I don't, for all the rappers, right, that's rapping about being in the streets or, you know what I mean, grabbing all these people and all this shit, you're going backwards. You're going backwards.
Yes, sir.
And taking some of these youth with them because the youths are hearing what they're saying and want to do what they're talking about doing.
Yeah, I'm like I said, I don't want to seem like I've never been that guy. You know what I'm saying? But I'm just telling them, like, be careful. I done been shot 5 times. You know what I'm saying? I done been to prison. I done been broke. I done been had money. I done been heartbroken. I done been every kind of, you know what I'm saying? I might not look like it. You know what I mean? Because I know it's part of it. And I got everything coming that I had coming. I deserved all that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
That's why I don't worry about it. I deserve to be shot.
Yeah.
I deserve to go to jail. I deserved all that. But it made me the person I am now. And I'm saying, man, I ain't doing shit.
And when you got shot,
man, you so right. Much, bro. I could go there with you because this is real, man. Right. Like, and I'll let you ask your question because you say when you got shot, so I'm not gonna get okay.
When you got shot before you went to prison?
I got shot after I got out of prison.
After you got out of prison, and yes. At that time you were trying to change your life.
Yes, yes.
And got shot.
And I got shot. Absolutely.
What happened?
I came out of the barbershop, and I saw a guy that went like that, and I went to watch him walk going that way. I said, oh shit, hey, he looks suspicious. I said he looked suspicious.
Yeah, that feeling.
I had that feeling. So I watched him walk that way. So I went to go get in my car. And then the guy that was a shooter was coming from this way. Mm. And I shot, you know, my arm. And then I balled up and got shot in the back. And my broke my femur and stuff like that. You know what I mean? And the guy that was walking,
he was a distraction.
Yeah, and then so he hopped over me. I was like, oh, shit. I was looking up at him. I thought he was going to hit me in the head.
Right.
But then he just jumped over me and he kept going. So I seen him.
Did they try to rob you or anything like that?
No, it wasn't no robbery.
It wasn't that type of thing.
Intended target. Okay. You know, I had it coming, but because I don't owe, I want people to know, like, you don't have to owe somebody no money. You don't have to be no snitch. You don't have to, and still, it'll go down. You know what I'm saying?
It
can still go down.
It can really go down.
It can really go down over nothing.
Yeah.
And a lot of these guys, a lot of my young guys, they thinking, all right, well, if I don't owe no money, or if I don't, you know what I'm saying? Or if you don't, yeah, I'm good, or if I don't have my jury on, or whatever. You know what I'm saying? So,
that's
true. But God had something else planned for you.
Yes.
That's why you still here.
I love the fact, man. Like I said, I keep going back to the fact of how, man, you already won. You still here. A lot of brothers ain't here no more, bro.
Absolutely.
I've been saying this lately to all my brothers, you know, that's, you know, we here. You know, he dead and gone now. One of my mentors say after 35, you go to a lot of funerals.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm being real. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So I think that's something to be here and still kicking it. You know what I'm saying? That's big, man, because you could have been gone.
Yeah,
and a lot of your friends are already gone.
Absolutely. But that's where we need to start, and I said that I wanted to challenge more of my guys, that's whether they're listening or whatever, that you got enough. You know what I'm saying? It ain't gonna never be. You know what I'm saying? Like, you got enough shit to walk away right now. You know what I'm saying? So if it can be one, and like I said, you guys interview a lot of niggas.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
For sure.
And none of the niggas really be, that I meet, be bragging about not in the game no more.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like, Nick, come on here and, you know what I'm saying, tell the kids that you ain't in that shit no
more. That's it. That's real.
You know what I'm saying?
That's real.
And then stand on that. You know what I mean? And that takes a harder walk because if once you say it out into the world and once you start walking it, it's hard. It's hard. You know what I mean? It's easy to go get some things and get rolling.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? For me, it's easy. That's light work. That's light work. We're in Las Vegas. I can go get to it. You see what I'm saying? But it's harder. And to be an example for my young kings and queens, that, you know what I'm saying, you got enough. You
Man.
Know what I'm saying? And guess what? Y'all probably got more than me. You know what I'm saying? I'm talking too real.
Listen.
The ones that's listening, man. You know what I'm saying?
Listen.
Enough.
You know, alhamdulillah, you say.
Alhamdulillah.
I wanna just go in on that. Like when did you go, you know, take
my shahada. This will be my third Ramadan.
That's
right. Alhamdulillah, that I am a Muslim. And I'm getting stronger and stronger in my faith. I'm getting more in my conviction. You know what I mean? But I've always been conscious of God and of Allah in particular. You know what I'm saying? Going to prison. But you just don't, or at least for me, and I don't want it to be for anyone else.
No,
I'm sharing my story.
Yes, sir.
Is that I didn't want it to be like, because I'm in jail. You know what I'm saying? I didn't want to be like, because I didn't been shot.
Yeah.
Or I don't want to be like, because I don't have no money.
Yeah, yeah.
But guess what? When I got the money, I knew what it was, cuz. I knew it was a lot. I knew
hey,
it was God.
Hey.
I knew it couldn't be nothing but God.
That's
when
it
came in.
Because
I knew it couldn't give credit to nobody else.
That's
because
how you
when I looked around and I said, how did it happen? And why me? Because I'm knowing I got some homies in Oakland just as smart, just as sharp. You know what I'm saying? Niggas is good looking. You know what I'm saying? Niggas, you know what I mean? Why me? You know what I mean? It couldn't be nothing but God.
Ain't nothing but God.
You see what I'm saying?
Now.
I know
Come
that.
On now.
And I knew that when I, you know what I mean? I don't know if it was a tap on my shoulder, if it was something that said, you know what? Said, man, you're going to be in front of that camera, man.
Man.
Right? Mm-hmm. You're going to be in front of that camera. And the only thing I need you to do is tell the truth. And you got everything else. Don't even worry about nothing. Just tell the truth. How did it happen? Oh, it was God. Alhamdulillah.
Hey, man, you know, like I said, man, you, what is, your son got a lot of people that's, you know, they say they, you know, when you get to be the champion, everybody want, they coming for you. You know what I'm saying? You got a lot of different challenges, man. Who, what's next?
Well, hey, my son is disrespectful, man. He don't even do that. Oh, he look behind the head. That's what you really want to say. Man, your son, man, he tripping. Yeah, he be tripping. So, and I told him, I said, listen, he's the undisputed champion of the world. He has every belt. And that goes without saying. He is, the lightweight division is on lock. And he has said that you must come through him.
Yeah.
In order to be a champion.
That's real.
Right? So with that saying, in a sport, that's the most disrespectful thing to say to the guys that are in your division.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So we don't have to say that they're not good fighters. I think that all of them are incredible fighters. I think that they all have great stories, right? They've stayed down, they've showed resiliency, even to be contenders, to be former world champions or future world champions. I don't have to say that. I just said that we got everything right now.
That's real. That's real. You know what I mean? That's real. Like I said, I said you guys. Where did he grow up at? What did your son Devin grow up at?
In my house.
In Vegas?
No, listen. Listen. Okay. Let me just tell everybody, because they doing it wrong. They keep saying what street. I'm a real one.
That's real.
My son. I took my son everywhere, all around countries. I took him to states, cities. Listen, we knocked on the good fighters that was in Newark. Hot, bad, super guy, talented guy, Shakur Stevenson.
Yeah.
Went and knocked on his door up there. Baltimore, Javonte Davis.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, before the world, you guys didn't know who he was. Mm-hmm. I've already gotten a car in a Sprinter with my son. We're going to Baltimore. Don't worry about it, son. You don't know who he is. I do.
Wow. Let's go.
You see what I'm saying? Because...
How did you choose all these different states that you're gonna go to? What was it so?
You know
special? What?
You know all the cities: Detroit, where they got the bad
news.
Yeah,
that's right.
New York, the Bronx, Brooklyn. Philly. You know what I mean? Listen, I didn't want him to hear no city, and it felt like it was no nigga that was nowhere better than him because he was from this project, that street, Chicago, whatever. It. You know what I'm saying? Like, I had already been to the federal penitentiary. I know everybody put on their pants one leg at a time. Mm-hmm. I just needed him to know that.
That's real.
Without going there. I needed him to know that it don't make no niggas nowhere different. We all the same. You know what I mean? It's what the skills you put in, the work you put in, not the street you from, not the rag you claim. That's some bullshit.
Yeah.
I had to let him know that. But the only way we can do that is... Then, now every the world say, do you know where he from? Do you know... My son don't give a fuck about nobody where they from.
That's real.
Guess what? And he got all A's. Because guess what? He was raised in my house.
That's real.
I'm the principal. My son, my 13-year-old son, he get all A's. Who grade him? Me. You're not going to tell me that my son, because he's not interested in your history, interested in your science.
Man.
I'm checking for his passion. Right?
Is it?
You know what I'm saying? I'm checking for, but I'm not to cut you off.
No, go.
My daughter, she's in traditional school. She's at Montessori school.
Wow.
My boys, you know, was different because I know what the peer pressure goes into with being a boy, being a young African American, in America. So we had a different level of what we how we raised my boys.
That's
you know what I'm saying.
No, I get
but my 13-year-old. No, you ain't. No. He got the curly hair. He light skinned. Y'all, you niggas ain't getting a hold of him with your gang banging and your shit. You won't see Sean Haney up there.
Okay, let's start with Devin first, because I know being a parent, no matter how much we try, sometimes those kids, they rebel, they do try to do what they want to do. Has there ever been a time with Devin that it was hard for you to get through your point of view or your to him and the things that he did before you could get through to him? Give me an example.
Well, it just depends. When I separate the father from the partner. That's why I speak on parent to partner, right? If it's his career and I'm in his business and then I go to tell him and I'm speaking to him as a dad or as a father, what does the dad shit come in at?
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? Am I researched? Am I versed? Am I his partner because I did my homework and now I'm introducing him to him to something? Well, if I've really did my homework on my partner, you understand that now ain't the day to be with the bullshit.
I like that.
Wow, that's real.
He don't want to hear you. You know what I mean? But if you want him to be open every day because you the daddy, then you got some other old shit going on. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. But I got other kids. So when one kid is going through something, what shit? I'm busy as a one-legged man in a butt-kicking contest. Real. Mm-hmm. I got to go over here and mm-hmm. deal with my daughter. Then I got my older son who I got my grandbaby. You see what I'm saying? So, you know, the bank ain't always open for them deposits. You know what I mean? But, you know, we always got them gems and jewels we trying to drop on
them,
right?
That's real.
But sometimes you go to the bank and it's closed. Uh-uh, here, I don't want to talk right now, Dad. I don't want to talk right now. Well, you can only hope that you live another day to make that deposit.
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
Exactly. You know, ain't no day promised.
You know, ain't no day promised. You don't want to get caught with it left in your purse or left in our pocket, right? We keep trying to drop everything on them, drop mm-hmm. everything on them before, you know, we can't, you know, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? So we understand what we're doing as parents, but at the same time, we got to also understand we've been kids before, and sometimes they don't be ready for it.
What's mm-hmm. up with Lomanchenko, the guy that...
Yeah, we'll fight him too. We got Lomachenko and Lomachenko. Yeah, we'll fight both of them.
Lomachenko, yeah. What's up with him? There's a lot of chatter around that.
No. Mr. Lomachenko and his team, and Devin and our team, we've been going back and forth and doing our best to make the thing happen. I can't
Is
say
it going to happen? Or no?
I hope that it's going to happen. You know what I'm saying? So I'm being optimistic about it and being positive. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I do too. I think that it's the Super Bowl of the lightweight division. It's the best fight in boxing. Lomachenko was the highest rated fighter outside of Mr. Tank Davis. So
I was about to mention him next.
Well, yeah, he's a tremendous talent. Like I said, we knocked on his door as well. And I do believe that these guys are good fighters. It's just something that's special about Devin.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's just something that's different. And we were able to learn right here in Las Vegas. We spent a lot of time with Floyd Sr.
Yeah, yeah.
Roger Mayweather.
Yeah.
Eddie Mustafa. You know, Virgil Hunter. Billy Giles out of New York. Roy Jones.
Yeah.
So when it came time to him learning, I didn't have no problem with bringing in the best of the best.
That's all.
So right. If Floyd Senior was away with Floyd Junior, then I would see Roy. If Roy had a fight, then you know what I mean. I would, I would rotate. I'd rotate to Eddie, rotate to Billy Giles. Just and you know, one thing that even as a fighter, Devin, he took in what he liked and what he didn't like, he left to the side. So everyone told me, they says, well, you got to watch out putting a fighter with one coach, I mean, with multiple coaches, because too many cooks in the kitchen spoil the pot.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I said, well, what about when you send your kid to a school and he got to learn six periods with six different teachers?
Yeah.
Six different personalities.
Yeah.
Writing substitutes and all this other stuff. I said, so why couldn't he learn from this trainer and this trainer? So while I was paying for it, I was learning the homework. I would say, come on, Dev. I said, you're not doing it like Floyd told you. Now, I know you with Eddie right now, and Eddie not going to tell you with Floyd, but we already paid Floyd Senior. I'm not going to, we're not going to go back over there and learn the shit again.
That's real.
You already learned it. You got tired of the same old thing, and that's why we started working with whoever, right?
And make it your own as well.
Right. So now we developed, and that's good thing that you say, Queen, because now we developed our own thing where we mix everything in.
That's it.
You know, I'll say come back with the hook like Eddie. I'll say take a look like Roy. You know what I mean? I'll say roll in, roll out like Roger. You know what I'm saying? Walk him down behind your shoulder like Senior. So you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's – and then so I say to everyone to say that we're not ready, I said it's an old saying, and you might know, I don't know if some of the youngsters, but it says, who's the lame that taught him the game and where did he learn to play?
That's real.
And the other part I was thinking, because with everybody, because sports, period, everybody have a strength and a weakness.
Yes.
So with this person teaching him everything he needs to know, you need to also watch what's that person's weakness and capitalize and fix that to make you a perfect machine.
Absolutely. 1,000%. It's about finding in your opponent, being able to, styles make fights, and being able to adjust to any style.
So one thing I like to go back into, and So when you were raised in Oakland,
East Oakland. It's a difference. It's a difference, and you'll only know that when you talk to somebody from Oakland. If they specify, if you say, "Hey, you from Oakland," and they specify they from East Oakland, they really from East Oakland.
That's real. That's real.
So were you raised with your mom and dad?
You know what? My mom and dad had an argument one day. You know, they was fussing and fighting and shit, and they came in, and they asked me, both of them standing on each side.
How old were you when they asked you this question?
Man, I was about 10, 9. Okay. I was 9. Yeah, I was 9.
And they asked you?
They said, "So who you want to live with?" She was like, "Enough." And she was like, "I'm taking him." And then they was like, "Well, no, I'm taking him." They was like, "So which one, who do you want to live with?" And I said, "I want to live with Grandma."
Eliminate all that.
But I didn't know that Grandma lived in the hood, bro. I mean, I knew it was the hood, but I didn't know growing up. Right. You know what I mean?
But you're the only child? After.
No, I had a little brother. Then he said, "I'm going with my brother. I'm going with him." And I was like, "Come on, man, let's go." You know what I'm saying? I was like, "Come on, let's go." So, you know, that was it. And then I never wanted to upset either one of them by spending more time at either one of them house, so I just stayed in the neighborhood, you know?
I'm telling you, man, like you remind me so much of myself, because my mom and dad got divorced at 9.
Oh, really?
I promise.
That's crazy. You still remember it, too,
I remember,
right? That's crazy.
But I stayed with Grandma most of the time. Grandma, heck yeah. Yeah. Man, because at the end of the day, she the one who could cook the best anyway.
Man, you know
Stop
what?
Playing.
Yeah. And you know what? My grandmama never talked about my mom. She never talked about my dad.
Yeah.
She never talked about them or none
that's
of that.
That's a good
you know what
grandma.
I'm saying? And that's the way I learned it. You know what I'm saying? So even with the parent-to-partner thing that with my son, right, he was 32 and he got a 3-year-old, and then I got a granddaughter that's on the way coming soon.
Congratulations.
Thank you, for sure. But it's about being a partner to him and not showing up with that, you know, grandpa got himself together more than my son. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And I've seen that happen so many times in the community where instead of working together to make my son or my daughter strong, right, we tend to come in and we come in strong as grandparents. I vowed, I said, once I become a grandparent, I'm going to become a partner to my kid and not overshadow with, right. You know what I'm saying?
That's make real.
Because they always spoil the grandkids and send them home to the parents
No, I'm not going to do that.
But I love the way how you put it together, because I've always heard being a parent, it's a fine line, especially when your kids reach a certain age, of trying to be their best friend compared to being a parent.
Yes.
There's a limit. And some parents end up trying to be too much of a best friend, and then that's when the disrespect comes in place, because you're not really still trying to be a parent, to say.
That's why I don't use the word friend. I use partner.
Mm-hmm.
And with anything that you have a partner, you have a mutual respect for each other versus just being, you know, considered a friend. Because I feel when you look across from the friend is on... can be on a different playing field, but when you're partners, when you truly become partners,
it's equal.
Mm-hmm. You know
that's
what
real.
I mean?
That's real.
And but also understanding that I'm the most experienced partner on the team, so it's easier for me to understand an 8-year-old than to understand an 8-year-old understand me.
Right. Right. That's real. That's real. Right? You like you was down in Dallas, wasn't you? You came to Dallas.
Yes, I did.
And me and you, I'm trying to figure out, I think we was in New Orleans.
Y'all wasn't there, no.
No, but I sent my guy over there.
Okay.
But he was there just a little bit. He got to talk to CeCe. And I was supposed to be here, and Black called me like, "Man, they coming. Everybody going to be over here. You got to." I said, "Man, no, we went to Chicago."
Mm-hmm.
We went to Chicago. And I was like, "Man, I'm going to miss it, because we're going to be in Chicago." That's what I was telling CeCe. That Harold's Chicken ain't messing around with nothing down there in Texas.
No.
we were going back and forth about that. But one thing I want to say is that CeCe went crazy when I interviewed her about Devin Haney. Man, she a big supporter,
man.
She wasn't trying to hear nothing else.
Yeah,
she
was screaming on
boy,
that
boy, she
mic.
Go here. That boy, like, I think she messed that mic up that day. She got a big voice, man. She is not playing.
No, she's special. She's special to
she
us.
She is.
she's special to our community. You know what I mean? I hold her in high regard, and I'm a big fan of what she's doing.
Yeah.
She,
right.
She didn't hit that thing running.
Yes, sir.
Right? And she can tell some hell of a story.
What? Man, we went down through there, man. And going to go down through there here in a minute. We got some stuff she ain't able to talk about, but it's coming where she's like, E, I'm coming to see you for anybody. So I just thank God for having favor. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
Favor ain't fair. But, hey, man, listen, I got Bill. Hey, I got Mr. Haney here today, man, and that's hard, man. And we in Vegas, man. What am I supposed to do out here? What's going on locally that I need to, is the food good? Where I need to go? What I need to do? You know everything.
You and the queen, you have the queen. You stay close to the queen.
For sure.
Y'all stay out of trouble.
Vegas, man, we freaking went up here. I was asking her on the way driving up from Cali.
Because he was like, tomorrow's Valentine's Day. What you want to do? Where you want to go? I'm like, I'm not picky at all.
There's some great restaurants here. You know, and it's the shows that are amazing.
Yeah.
I don't know what show.
Yeah, we've done some.
I've been wanting to go see Usher. That's crazy.
I heard his show is good.
None of my gangster homies get mad at me. Usher on the roller skates. That's a good one. And then the comedy shows. Mike Epps was here.
That's all.
The other day. You know what I'm saying?
So and Eddie Griffin stays here. Yeah. Like he does.
I haven't saw Eddie Griffin yet, but I've seen almost every other.
Really?
Yeah, comedian. The shows.
Wasn't Monique here for a while? She was, what they call it? Residency.
Residency.
I don't know if she was a resident here, but I know Eddie Griffin is a resident.
Eddie Griffin has been. Yeah,
that's hard, man.
He's still here,
man. Is it a myth or you stay away from these casinos? Don't be in here gambling.
Man, don't y'all get no
getting
trouble,
these money, man.
Don't do that. Man.
Some locals be up in there gambling. I've met some locals.
I ain't never seen these lights go off in this place, man. And nobody never hit them so hard that none of these casinos, you mean to tell me?
Nothing ever went down.
They stay on, though. They stay winning, but they never lose.
They never lose, man.
They're making more than they're giving out.
Wow.
So how do you like where the music industry is in today versus where it was? Because you know a lot about it.
No, I love the fact that every time in each industry, they say that it's dead. And now it's so much more money in music now.
Yeah.
Than it was, you know what I mean, 10 years ago.
Now 100%. You know what I mean?
And that's all that we as a people can want for our youngsters. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Our young kings and queens, I should say, is that they get a chance, a good bite at that apple.
You
know what I mean? And they bite that for real.
Man, so how often do you go up to East Oakland?
Oh, I own property there.
Okay, so you go home. You go every now and then.
No, I go all the time.
You frequent?
I go all the time.
Okay,
yeah, I got property out there, so I you know what I mean, I keep up with my shit.
Is it a reality check there? Like, is that old person there that say, "Man, Bill, man, the old man"? Is it old man there? It's always good to go.
No, you know what? And it's good because everybody seems so genuine and so proud.
That's all.
You know what I mean? Of me, and I love my city, and I love what the people, you know, my friends have done for me, but I respect what they haven't did to me.
Yeah.
There's a lot of niggas that have seen me at a time and I didn't see them.
Yeah.
And they gave me a pass.
Yeah.
Or it was something that somewhere in the person said, "Nah, that Bill, he all right, man. You know what I'm saying? Let him go." I love all them niggas.
And the reason I asked you that, and when I said that, I'm just saying, you know, like, it's always good to have, like, when we go home, the older person, is he still there? That old man or that old woman that knew you when you was a kid? You know what I mean? And I don't have a lot of that.
No. The old, I think we the old men.
You see what I'm saying? That's got to be
old.
That's it.
How did you feel the first time somebody called you an OG?
OG, unk. That's it.
You know what? The OG stands for the other generation.
Give it to me.
They're still doing it.
There you go. Hey, listen, it's something different about us, though. We ain't like, well, I don't know. I remember that old guy in them khakis. And
they're not the same
color. Nah, Willie, look at this dude, man.
That's what they
is. Fly as ever, man.
And I've been hearing that's a good thing that they say that, like, you know, it's not what it used to be. I'm telling you, man, I'm happy, man. And yeah. I can see that you happy
as well. I'm blessed, man.
You know what I'm saying?
Totally blessed. Right. I ain't going to even play with it. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, I be like, man, this is, I feel good. You know what I mean? Yeah. It's a lot of times, man, where I know where I come from, man, you know, and it's a lot of preserving when you be locked up, too. People don't talk about that part. It'll preserve you, man, you know. What was the thing that changed the most when you came home from that? I know it was a long time ago, but when you came home, something that was like, damn, I can't believe that changed on me.
Cell phones, of course.
No, that was before then. When did you get? You had 92.
92.
So it was.
Okay.
Man, that's so long ago. The music is forever changing.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I think that was one of the things. And of course, you know, not having money and then, you know, your friends that have might have appeared to be one way, but was what we called really, you know what I mean? You know, opportunists or whatever, you know what I'm
saying?
Right? That when you were doing good, then they had the opportunity that they could do good. And then when you weren't doing good, that they didn't see the same opportunity in you. So that's always something different, but I was so happy to be home, and I think that, you know, because I smile a lot, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I have fun, and then I can fight too.
All that's working.
It's like, you know, I done made somebody mad, and instead of them coming to talk to me or come slap the shit out of me, you know what I'm saying? Nigga just decided to shoot me. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Did you have trust issues when you came out?
That's big.
Trust.
Because just for the main fact of what you just said, that, you know, a lot of people who you thought that was cool with you and stuff like that before you went in, coming, you know, and you gone for that time, they didn't probably call, visit, nothing. So when you came back out, makes you wonder, like, who is really down for me from who is not and all of that sort of stuff.
Absolutely. You're going to always run into, you know, who can you trust or,
right.
You know what I'm saying? Like that kind of thing. But, I'm just happy to be home. You know what I'm saying? That's what I was.
It's a blessing.
I was just happy to be home, man.
Go ahead. Boy, she put the thing on me, man. Boy, that's big. Go ahead.
No, I wanted to go back into, okay, so Devin, I remember when you said that at, I think it was age 8 when you took him for his first boxing.
Yes.
Okay. And you were told that he is talented.
A natural.
How long after when you say, you know what, I'm going to put my all into him, I'm going to invest in him, I'm going to do what it takes to make him a champ, how long after that did that come into your head?
Yeah, you know what, it's funny because just thinking back on it, my friend John White, and you know, he has one baby, you know, just as, well, I say baby, the same age as
Devin.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? And he told me, he was like, Bill, I can't say, you know, I could go back and do it again after doing what we did with Devin, meaning I went and got him a boxing gym right over on Sahara, right? His own boxing gym when he's like 10 years old, right? And for someone to do that, you know, that's pretty crazy.
Mm.
You know, I mean, I was really believing in him. But after seeing him, what he did to that boy that first time, I said, ooh, we got something. I said, we got some.
Yeah, so
that's why I always.
So you went right into it.
Yeah, no,
that.
Just if you would have seen it, because he was already fighting.
You should have videoed it.
I didn't know it was going to go down like that, Corey. I swear I didn't. I thought he was going to whoop. I took him there to get whooped.
And he taught you. He already knew he had some.
Yeah.
Already.
Yeah. But how much did it cost? Like, because I know a lot of people. When I say people are watching who. Maybe their child want to start boxing, or that child themselves say, you know what, I'm going to raise up some money to send myself through boxing.
Mm-hmm.
How expensive can it be to really just get up and, you know, with the talent to get up and get going?
You know what, boxing is you don't get paid a lot till you get paid a lot, but it's expensive. It's crazy because it's expensive.
Yeah.
For the training and stuff, but to pay, that's just real weird. But if you get someone to believe in you, a coach to believe in you, you know, it can happen. You know what I'm saying? I don't want to say any kind of number because I don't know any kind of number. Every number is different. But one thing that I can say is that if you have faith and you're doing the right thing, mm-hmm. man, God will make a way.
Won't he do it?
That's the only thing I really believe.
I believe that too.
And I was talking to someone today, and mm-hmm. then they told me, they was like, you take care of so many people.
Mm-hmm. That's hard.
And they're like, I'm concerned. I don't want you to like have no what? I was like, what? I said, what you mean, like a nervous breakdown or something? And no, then I was like, you. And then I was looking, right. Yeah. That's the part I was like, so, but they wouldn't say it. They was like, no, I just want you to be, you know, just stay healthy and what's the name? I said, listen, if I can take care of a quarter of the people, right? And you feel like you it's okay to take care of a quarter of people. Mm-hmm. And then she said, yes. She said, yeah, like a quarter of people. I said, well, why? You only have an expectation out of you to take care of, I have an expectation I can take care of all of them.
Mm. Yeah, I mean? Yeah, yeah.
Like we just have different expectations, right? I have something I'm asking different of God than you. Because right. I know it's all comes from God. So why are you only asking for a quarter when you can ask for 100?
Man, that's so true.
I like that.
Yeah, that's real. Kid Austin.
Floyd Schofield.
Your son is the champion. Everybody's gunning for your son, man.
Alhamdulillah. Listen. This is what you.
I love
this
it.
Is the place that you work for, and out of respect. But the ones like Kid Austin to tell the truth and say they want to fight, I have more respect for them than the ones that say they don't know who he is.
Wow, mm-hmm. That's hard. That's real. That's so, you know, real. I mean? Yeah.
I hate when people do that.
Yeah, I know. Do you know anybody that said that?
Not about him, but I know people who say that. I don't know this person.
I was going to ask you, so y'all going to make me forget, man. I can't stand y'all, man. The last fight. You couldn't go to the last fight.
Yeah, that's what they said. They
what was that all about?
Why?
Well, because of the felony.
The felony. I figured that's what it was.
You know what I mean?
Where was it being held?
It was in Australia.
They do that.
But yeah, but the Victorian government, they, you know, thank God that they made the right decision. Let me come over. You know, they entrusted that
they make an exception.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, they made an exception. That's they entrusted that I was going to come in to do the right thing. You know what I mean? They had looked at everything, you know, the rap sheet and all this stuff and made the decision. They made the right decision because that's all I want to do is go.
Right. And support them.
Be there for my son.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, I just, you know, I'm going to be honest with you, man. I just love the fact that you came on Boss Talk 101. I'm so humble, bro. It mean a lot to me, man. We didn't know what we was doing when we first started this thing, man. But God, by faith. You know what I'm saying? We walk by faith, not by sight. Yes. So when we put this together, there was a time when we walked around with cameras and didn't nobody know what I was doing. And that's the way God will do you. You don't know what's going on, but he'll make it all make sense in the end. You know what I'm saying?
Yes,
just like when you took your son to that gym. Yes, and you was going to teach him a lesson, but God had a lesson to teach you. You know what I'm saying?
Mashallah, man. Things worked out great.
Man, you know, the time has come, man. I'm finna shut it down.
I got a question.
I'm finna shut it down.
My question is, what is the age, longevity for a fighter? Like, up till what age?
It varies.
You know what? It does. It does.
It varies.
And how they take care of their body and stuff. Of course, you see TBE. Floyd, he's at 45. He's still doing exhibitions.
For sure.
And I think...
But exhibitions is not like a real fight.
Yeah, no, but they're...
I'm talking real.
They'll pay $9 million.
Yeah, that money is real.
Well, that's tough. Yeah.
But it is an exhibition, and so you're right. But from a competitive standpoint, I believe that... I think George Foreman might have been the oldest guy.
And how old was that?
Texas. That's where you asked me where I was from.
How old was George Foreman?
He was old because he won his championship. Yeah, he was 50. He was whooping people at 50.
Yeah. Okay. But that's course rare. Not the norm. Yeah, that's very rare. I think where they're in their prime is like 32 to.
Yeah.
And then they retire after that?
They retire about 34, 35.
Okay. 36. And if they haven't lost their belt, is retire with the belt?
Yeah, retire with the belts.
Retire
with the belts.
Yeah. You know, you, like I said, man, thank you for coming on the show. You know, if people trying to, you know, These people out here got dreams, man. How can they get a hold of you? Can they go through Instagram and reach out to you? And
yeah, well, you know, I told you, you can go on TikTok.
But you said go on TikTok, but what is a TikTok handle?
Bill Haney.
Bill Haney? Hey.
Coach Bill Haney.
And what do you be doing on TikTok anyway?
I'm trying to get my followers up so my daughter will see. That's why y'all go on there, because she like that.
Do you do dances?
No, I actually do some talking and you know, kind of like just let everyone know what I'm going through in my life, you know, and how these experiences have affected me. And
that's real.
I'm getting up every day in the mornings. I get up after Fajr prayer and I try to say something, you know what I mean?
Positive.
Yeah, just positive. You know, some things like that. And so I put those on there. Of course, because that's what I do. I'm not a big dancer or nothing, but you know, I can show her that daddy can put up what he does and she can be comfortable putting up what she does, and it doesn't have to be something that somebody else is, you know, doing, or, you know, because they're dancing or because they're doing the makeup. That's not our thing.
If she ever got up and said she wanted to box, would you let her?
That's a hard one right there, but
boxing is a tough sport.
It's a tough sport.
But like females out there be boxing now.
Well, she got to just get in a couple fights at school first. No, I don't want to hear that. I don't want to hear this, but you know, but Dev, like I said, we turned the negative into a positive and found that he had a natural gift that that God gave him. You know, he likes to move out the way and, you know,
and
what
don't
I mean?
Get hit.
Yeah, and he doesn't take it personal if you guys fight.
Yeah.
And then you guys can be friends after, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know, but can you fight somebody and then just be friends after?
It take a little bit, but we get there. You know, we might be friends, but it gonna take
it
a little bit.
It depends. Like if we were friends before and it was just a fight and we just, you know, get over it, we can be friends.
Okay. All right.
No. It take a little bit, bro.
Yeah, it take a little bit with him. Even with him, like in sparring, right? Now you'll call the sparring partner up and you'll talk to him, hit him up, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Get ready, he goes over there, they commit to try to kill each other.
Mm-hmm.
Right. You know what I'm saying? And then, but they're helping each other, but they're trying to kill each other. You know, so it takes something that's really special to be a fighter, and that's why I always give them guys their props. You know what I mean? But I don't make it no mistake though. I'm in the Devin Haney business.
Yay!
Hey, that's sparring.
That's real. As you should be.
Yeah.
Does sparring partners give their all when they're fighting? Like sparring?
Well, they should.
Because I'm thinking you don't want to hurt the investment before a big fight.
Yeah, but then you also don't want the investment to go in there not prepared.
That's
so,
right.
You know
that's
what I mean? So you want to try to give, you want to try to give the correct work. And you know what I mean? If the fighter is on that level where chances is that if you're the sparring partner, and then why aren't you the fighter? You know what I mean? Like if you can do all that you're doing, then you shouldn't probably be a sparring partner. And if you're that much ahead of the guy that you're sparring, like you're holding back,
I got you.
Then you're not a sparring partner. So,
kudos to you, man. You mentioned something earlier, and I ain't forgot it yet. You said Jay-Z, 50 Cent, everybody came about, you know, Devin, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, definitely.
That's big, man.
Well, any moment.
And respectfully declined.
Respectfully.
Yeah, well, exactly. But that's what we worked.
That's why you
to get the attention of, you know what I mean, the moguls, big wigs, you know, and alike to be interested. But unfortunately, you know, I had a vision that they couldn't see. And normally, you know, that's just the way that thing go. When God gives you a vision, he gives it to you. He didn't give it to nobody else. So when you actually trying to explain it to them, you can't get frustrated because they don't see the vision God gave you.
Man.
You know what I mean?
That's so real.
So that's why I said respectfully, they did the best. All of them did the best and put it on the table. They didn't have to have us come over. They didn't have to come to the house. Come to the office. You know what I mean? So I'm thankful to all that. And each and every time, it was kind of like we wanted X, and they said, well, you could get X, but you need Y, right? So we went out and got Y to get us to Z.
Man,
God gave you that vision, how hard was it to get Devin on board? Because sometimes your partner.
When I saw him, his natural gift.
Okay.
I said, and then being in the town with Floyd and seeing Floyd, I said, you know what, Dev? I said, man, I said, watch that dude.
That's real.
I said, don't watch that, man. I said, this shit, they're going to come and tell you that dad is the nigga. That's what they're going to tell you.
Right.
Even my friends, when you go do some bad shit, they're going to say, you just like your daddy. Or don't listen to your daddy. He was bad just like you. I said, man, don't listen to them niggas. I said, dad going to tell you.
That's real.
It's a nigga that's tearing the money down in the town named Floyd George.
That's right.
That's real.
You see what I'm saying?
That's real.
And then Floyd, you know, of course, I you know, after Devin was boxing and shit like that, I told Floyd, I said, you know, my son box, I want you to sing. You know what I mean? And he said, yeah. He been working with his dad.
Yeah.
His dad at that time. He said, okay, what time y'all gonna go to the gym? And when Floyd seen him, like everybody else, he said, Bill, you got something.
That's hard, boy. That's a big deal because of all that he done been through and the dad. Man, y'all seen it coming a mile away.
Absolutely. It's been a blessing.
Man, thank you so much for coming on the show, man. We love you, brother.
Thank you, brother, man. Love you as well.
Family as well,
thank
man.
Thank you, Queen.
Say, man, it's been another great segment of Boss Talk 101.
Can I tell him too?
Yeah.
But follow Real Devin Haney and get it for real. Instagram. You got me, Bill Haney _ on Instagram, you know. And I do got OnlyFans too.
Hey,
but wait a minute. You ain't gonna see no ass. You're gonna get to the cash.
Yeah.
You come talking to me, and for the whatever it is a month, you're gonna be able to get it straight and stay on course.
That's all. Yes, sir.
So you on Clubhouse and all of that too?
Yeah, I'm on Clubhouse.
You on Clubhouse?
No half stepping. We just started it.
Ooh, yeah. I still don't understand Clubhouse.
No, we just started. It's called No Half Stepping. And we're in the process of doing our first date.
When y'all gonna do it, man? Tell me. Tell me like how it is. I don't know nothing about it. I just seen it. I see different people do it. I know people be arguing on there a lot of time. I want to see what this work is. It boxing gonna be pretty much the core of it?
Yeah, no, but we're not just boxing. We're just gonna cover the lifestyle and business and how to make money. And parenting and you know what I mean.
That's all.
Some of this good black culture.
That's real.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. So. And just be open platform, and I don't want to be, you know what I mean, the end all, the be all, the beginning, and none of that. I just want to get on there with some other like-minded individuals, and let's rap on it.
That's all, man.
What's your end goal with all of this? Like, with Devin, with the parenting, with everything?
That this will be a parent-to-partner planet. My goal is that 1 million families will be connected and partnership that are disconnected now. And if it means getting help from 1 million parents and partners that are doing well and they sponsor a family like the beautiful family,
man,
you guys
thank
sponsor
you.
Another family, because we can't do everything. We shouldn't be expected to do everything, but if we can do one thing as a family, adopt another family, and we can get 1 million people to do that, 1 million families, I think that this is better.
And he's only here in Vegas right now.
Well, I'm looking to do it worldwide, and I hope to do it worldwide. You know, I know that I have parents and partners that are a part of the organization that are not just here in Vegas. We're looking to have an event here in Las Vegas, but this will be something that is for the community. It's not just a representation of me, but we want to be able to address trauma that goes on in the family, because a lot of trauma between the parents and the partners, the parent and the child, so to speak, right? So we want to deal with that. It's a lot of parents and children that are disconnected financially. If we can get some money, it's parents that are left behind.
That's big.
Parents that are left behind in prison. You know what I mean?
It's real.
That aren't.
Children end up on the streets.
Right. And what I stress to me, coming from, you know, being in prison, that a lot of those brothers are, they should be used to show what you shouldn't do.
Yeah.
Like they can, like, all the brothers that are in jail, I tell them, thank you, man, because when you call my sons, when you call me and my sons hear you, I say that's Uncle Tata on the phone, right? And you're like, damn, Ty's still in there. Or that's E, or that's, you know what I mean? Right? So they keep my shit straight.
That's real.
But they don't know it.
Yeah.
You know, and I tell them all the time, I say, bro, I use you as an example.
Yeah.
I said, so all the guys that aren't ain't then hung themselves, aren't taking pills, that call in the 100% solid mm-hmm. and tell myself, you don't want to be here, thank you. I tell them thank you all the time. And if we can get more examples out to these kids, because sometimes these kids, like with my dad, you know what I mean? He's a blue-collar worker. I didn't think that he was hip.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I thought this other nigga was hip.
Yeah.
So I didn't listen to him. So now I say is, let's go take these kids and see these guys in the prison. Let's bring the kids out. I mean, when the guys get out from prison, one of the requirements is that they speak to kids.
That's real.
You know what I mean? You need to speak to the kids and let them know where you came from, why the story is fresh on your mind.
Why you really don't,
you know what I mean? Why you really are mad that you was there, but you really feel that pattern. They need to feel it. Because for some reason, I keep it. You know what I'm saying? For some reason, I keep.
You keep you home.
I keep the fact that tonight, you know what I'm saying, I want to get home. You know what I'm saying?
When
I was driving, you know what I'm saying, I kissed my daughter and all the stuff. You know, I always think about it and say, and I never think about it in the daytime, but at nighttime, for some reason, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I always say, you know.
Think it's more dangerous.
Well, yeah, I just say, damn, you know, I want to get home. Yeah, it could happen. You know what I'm saying? You know it could happen.
Yeah.
I say, damn, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Let me just stay focused so I can get back. But if you have a couple drinks, a smoke, you know what I mean? That spidey sense that you get and start dying down.
Yeah,
and then
you
end up standing around. And mm-hmm. around. But initially, when you're going out, your first thought is to get back home.
Yes. You got to get back home, man. Like I said, man, I never seen this coming. Again, shout out to Fight Fan, man, Black, my guy, man, CC, man, for holding us down like they always do. I can't just stop thanking them enough for the people that they always refer us to and call us family, man. That's big. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
And now you family. And guess what? One day, we may even have Devin on here, so y'all better stop playing. Boss Talk 101, Devin will come through now. It's already been solidified. Dad is here. Family.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? Thank you so much, man. God bless you, brother.
It's
been another great segment of Boss Talk 101, where the bosses talk.
And we out.
Absolutely.